How you guys doing? Enjoying the end of the world a little bit? I know I am. It's been fun, airports and things. It's exciting out there. So you heard I'm a coffin expert, right? Does that kind of freak you out? A little bit weird? It freaks my parents out. I grew up in Houston, Texas, and they're like, Kara, what are you doing? What's going on? Doesn't seem to fit the expectations of my birth and station, or I don't know. But if you put a coffin in front of me, Egyptian coffin, I'll be able to say 18th dynasty, 21st dynasty, 26th dynasty. It's a strange and unusual skill. And I'm not doing it to date the coffins. I'm interested in coffins for the same reasons that growing up in Houston, Texas, was very formative. I grew up in a land of big cars and big hair. And everything was about social competition. And I went to one of the most socially competitive high schools that you can possibly imagine, like Mean Girls on steroids. And when I look around at people, I'm always the anthropologist. I'm looking at clothes, I'm looking at shoes, I'm looking at hair, I'm looking at display and the presentation of people. And I do very much the same thing with these Egyptian coffins. It's a little bit strange to look at society through the eyes of the dead, but it's what they're using. It's what they used in the ancient world. It's their means of competition. It's a way for a family to put their best foot forward. To say, we have more money than you, look at all of the gold, look at all of the blue paint, whatever fancy stuff they can put on there. So the other reason I look at coffins is because I'm interested in crisis studies and apocalypses, the end of the world, in a sense. And this coffin that I'm looking at here comes from a time period known as the Bronze Age Collapse. Does that mean anything to anybody here? Around 1200 to 1000 BCE, when the world as known was, it started to just crumble and fall. And access to wood and pigments and all of these things became very, very difficult. And so the elites, the rich people who were competing with these coffins, decided, well, we can't get access to new wood, so we have to reuse the coffins of our ancestors. And out of these 300 that you mentioned, coffins that I have looked at around the world, about 80% of them show evidence of reuse, which means they take a body out, move it to the side, bring the coffin to a workshop, replaster it, repaint it, and update it like you would a kitchen or a bathroom. That work, it's extraordinarily interesting to me, certainly brings in this idea of imagination. If you can't get the wood that you need, you've got to be innovative. You've got to find another way of going about it. And this is one way for the Egyptians to continue their work with coffins, but not have access to the materials. Now, this work is very, I have to be very nitpicky. I have to cross all my T's, dot all my I's, make sure that I'm doing it right. So this work comes as a relief, a breath of fresh air. It makes me remember why I went into graduate school in the first place. No more spreadsheets, no more careful documentation. I can muse, I can think out loud. I can compare the world of ancient times to today and try to note patterns and try to figure out what's going on. And so I do this weird coffins thing, but I have another side of me where I'm interested in women's studies and particularly women in power. Why do we not want it? Why are we hostile to it? I think for those of you that follow politics, I don't really need to convince you that women in power, these are problematic things to put together. I think it was after 2016 with Hillary Clinton, given how polarizing she is, people said, oh, it's because of Hillary Clinton. And now that we've gone through another cycle, you can see, no, you have women coming from right or left. It is very difficult for women to find a way into power. And that's what led me to this as an Egyptologist, because, and here's our reality, right, just to give you a quick visual of what it is that we're dealing with. But Egypt is this strange and unusual place that allowed women into power regularly, systematically, They needed them to be in power. And I started writing this book, When Women Ruled the World, about six queens of ancient Egypt, five of whom became nothing less than king, trying to figure out, what were the Egyptians doing? How were they so much more enlightened than us? What did they know that we don't know? Because we in the United States have never had a female leader of state. The Egyptians had many of these. So how are we to understand this? Let's start with a map. I'm an educator. I teach at UCLA, chair of my department there. So this looks like your basic history class, right? History professors love to start with a map. I'm doing so for a reason, to try to find the reasons why Egypt may be different from other places. Now look at that map and see how you've got desert on east and west, Mediterranean Sea to the north, and then down south, right about here, you've got these big granite boulders in the middle of the river, and you are encapsulated and protected. It's like there's walls all around this place. You don't have foreign invasion in large numbers at all. It's hard to get through that desert. It's hard to have a naval invasion from the sea. And if there's a big granite boulder as big as this room in the middle of the Nile, you're not going to be able to bring a navy up either. So not very much internal warlording either, because this river that cuts through this expanse of the desert makes farming truly easy. And it was Herodotus of the 5th century that went to Egypt, and he's like, oh my God, you guys, check it out. You know how farming in Greece is so hard, and you have to move all the rocks, and you have to get your plow out and break the dry soil, and then you sow the seeds, and then you just pray for rain, and if the rain doesn't come, we all starve. And everyone's like, yes, we do this every day. We know exactly what you're talking about. He's like, well, just went to this awesome place called Egypt, and the Nile floods its banks every year on clockwork, exactly when it's supposed to, leaves about this much new earth. You just throw the seeds out there and let the livestock run on it. And like 2 months later, you get as many fat, juicy kernels of wheat and barley as you can possibly imagine. So Egypt is this place that is risk-averse, likes the status quo, does not need to warlord. Everybody is essentially full on cheap carbs and a little bit drunk all the time. So people don't need to be fighting with each other constantly because they have everything they need. Even in time periods of recession, downturn, Egypt is doing much better than other parts of the Mediterranean or North Africa. It is this special and unusual place. So that is going to set up why we have this. When you think of Egypt, you think of King Tut, right? You think of the pyramids. You think of all of these ciphers in your mind that are associated with the king, that are associated with authoritarian power. And this is the dirty secret of what it is I'm talking about. I write this book with a sly title called When Women Ruled the World. Makes it sound awesome. But the only reason those women are ruling the world is to prop up this. A patriarchal system, an authoritarian system, an extraordinarily unequal system, that if it fails, if something comes in and messes with it, say the king is out riding his chariot one day and he falls off and dies, and he leaves a harem nursery full of a bunch of 12-year-olds. This place is going to allow one of those 12-year-olds to be chosen as king. They will bow down in front of him and think of him as Horus incarnate upon earth. What would happen in a more competitive place, like Greece, or like Rome, or Mesopotamia, or Syria? That kid would be dead before the month was out, and some warlord would be holding the bloody knife and say, I'm king, and everyone would be like, yes, you are. Good for you. You're a king. But in Egypt, they're like, oh, my liege Horus, what would you have me do? So this, does anyone else hear the ringing? I'm going to let it go. It's a normal thing. That's just me. I'm on high alert. This is just me. Okay, so now our divine kingship has been weakened in some way, right? King's dead, and we have a new king on the throne, but he's just a kid. Let's say he's a 10-year-old kid, because that's the boy that I have at home. Anyone know any 10-year-old boys? Do you want them to be making decisions on behalf of all of Egypt? So I know what my kid would choose, and it's not pretty. So you have two choices. You can be so patriarchal and believe so much that women don't know anything. This is what they were like in Greece. Just read some Hesiod, where he talks about women, compares them to cattle, says how stupid and deceitful they are. In Greece, this is not going to happen, right? Women cannot rule. They're incapable of it in their cultural mindset. So if you're that patriarchal, then you're going to pick a man to rule. But if you're in Egypt, you're going to think, wait a minute, if we have a man make the decisions as a regent on behalf of this boy, what's going to happen? Potentially. Let's say you bring in the brother of the dead king, the kid's uncle. What could potentially happen? I mean, maybe the uncle's a really sweet guy, but maybe he's going to kill the kid, take the kingship for himself, hold up the bloody knife and say, I'm the king, and everyone will be like, oh, okay. To be risk-averse, the Egyptians invited women into power. And more specifically, they invited the kid's mother into power. So, and that makes sense, right? Because if you've got a mother coming in to be queen regent on behalf of her son, he can be a god king, and she's the mother of the god, and she can still be like, sit up straight in your throne, Horus. I put your crown on. I told you to do it this way. And he's like, yes, mom. And she's not going to compete with him in a way that's going to take away his power. She's going to maintain that power. She's going to watch him grow and be super proud and then step back into the shadows, not try to take it from him. Now, about five times in ancient Egyptian history, these women found a way to transcend that queen regency and become nothing less than king. It's a big deal to use the word king at all. And some of you in the audience are probably saying, why is she saying king? I don't like that. We could use the word queen instead. The Egyptians used the word king. So in my writing, I call them female kings. They deserve nothing less. For the Egyptian language, the word queen was helpmate of the king, wife of the king. It connoted no power. That's why they used the word queen, and I will use the word queen. Now, when the women, those five women transcended this queen regency, they were extraordinarily imaginative in how they did this. They managed to look at the system and game it and find a way to get ahead. And those are the patterns that I'm going to focus on today. I have six women that I want to talk about, five of whom became king. And just to make it clear, there were hundreds of women who were queen regents who never reached this level of power. So Egypt, in its risk adversity, in its attempt to keep this place safe from warlording, allowed women into power more often than not. That implies, and many of you can argue with me afterwards in the Q&A, that women rule differently than men, inherently. That women are less violent than men, that they warlord less, that they're less problematic, less competitive. We can discuss, and we'll have to start it off with our first one, Merneith of Dynasty I. Now, you'll notice that we start talking about one of these women as soon as kingship comes around in ancient Egypt. So as soon as kingship is invented, very first dynasty, you start to see a strong queen regency coming alongside it. It is two sides of the coin, the king and a strong queen, strong female protector. Oh, here, I'll move. And Merneith of Dynasty I is 5,000 years old to us. Gives you a little insight of what a gift Egyptology is to us. How old is the United States? 250 years or something, right? So we have no understanding of what long durée is, what deep time is. I, as an Egyptologist, can look at booms and busts and ups and downs over a long period of time, about 3,000 years of time, the same language, same religion, same political system, and give you all kinds of ideas about Egyptian innovations in response to crisis, in response to good times, bad times. It's very, very helpful to see what people might do when everything falls apart or when everything's going really well or when a woman gains an extraordinary amount of power and how she gains that amount of power. Now, Merneith of Dynasty I, when her tomb was found by archaeologists, she's in a long lineup of other tombs at a place called Abydos. The Egyptians say Abydos. And you have a king's tomb, another king's tomb, another king's tomb. So let's say we're digging here, and this is Merneith's, and then another one there. And the archaeologists finding it are like, oh, it's just another king's tomb. It's in the lineup of the other ones. We get it. But then they look at this stela, and they're like, something's wrong. Something's going on. Because if you compare it to other kings' names, there are two things missing. And the two things are this Horus bird, right? That's the symbol of kingship. That's Horus. That's kingship in its divine form. And then the other thing you're missing is this rectangular image of the palace, that mud brick structure that was whitewashed and became a symbol of the kingship itself. In the same way, when we talk about the White House releasing a statement, and it's an institution of the kingship, the Egyptians did the same thing. And eventually they created the word pharaoh, which means the palace. That's where the word pharaoh comes from, per-a-a. And so Merneith is missing those two things, no Horus bird and no palace. Her name here means beloved of the goddess Neith, but she is not a king, and they didn't even realize it was a she until they found this tiny, tiny label about this big in a tomb next door, and it's a king list. You have King Jer, and look at that's how he's marked as king, Horus Jer, Horus Jet, Horus Den. For those of you that are practicing your hieroglyphs, that's a D, that's an N, fancy. And then here, you're like, oh, I see a vulture, right? That's the symbol for mother. And this is the symbol for the king, so king's mother, and there's her name, Merneith. You're like, okay, it's a queen regent, it's the king's mother, and she's there in the list of other kings. She's buried like a king. This is a powerful woman. How are we going to reconstruct this history that is 5,000 years old? It's amazing we can say anything at all about this history. Inside of the tomb, well, let's go back. Let's go back and imagine Merneith as an 11-year-old, 12-year-old, 13-year-old kid. How does she get to the point of being the queen regent? What was her life like up to that point? The most traumatic moment Merneith would have experienced is the death of this King Jer, who may very well have been her father. Because at this time period in Dynasty I, when a king died, they sacrificed hundreds of people to accompany him, to make sure he did not go into the grave alone, to take away threats to the throne, to make sure that everyone knew that this king had power over life and death, and also to aggrandize the death of the king. So you can watch the burial of the king go into the ground and people are mourning because they knew that king and loved him and there's keening and mourning. But now, imagine taking elites, people you ate at table with, brothers, sisters, mothers, daughters, and murdering those people in front of their family members by the hundreds. And the keening and the mourning would have been that much more apparent. People are practically dying from the grief. When the king dies, you have a whole group of people dying with him, and they feel a part of themselves lost as well. This practice of sacrificial burial is something you see around the world when kingships are developed. You see it independently of one another. You'll see it in Africa. You see it in the New World, in North America, South America, Central America. Cahokia, nearby, sacrificial burial in response to a new kingship. You see it in Asia. It is everywhere. In Egypt and in most places, it's very short-lived. You can't murder all of your elites in front of their eyes and expect to get away with it for very long. It's an expensive practice, but it sure establishes power very, very quickly. Merneith, as a girl, would have witnessed this. She probably saw her own mother die. This tomb is filled with females, mostly women. She may have held her mother as she had to drink a poison of some kind and watched her die. The details are not clear, but this is what the markers of the dead look like. Each one got a room of their own. You even have some of the detritus of death, the dead themselves. Merneith herself is not sacrificed. Can't be. We know that she's going to become very important. She is going to marry the next king. She's not the only wife. Egypt is risk-averse. They're going to establish a harem, a group of women who are there to intensify the production of the king. And when this guy dies, about 328, that's what archaeologists have found, I guarantee you it would have been more, are sacrificed to go into the ground with him. Now, who's king next? Because remember, this is the way kingships work. King is dead, long live the king. This dude dies, the next guy comes in. The next guy is King Den, Merneith's son. Merneith is queen regent. Merneith is the one that is making the decision of who lives or dies. You. How is she going to choose? First of all, the fact she's doing it all means that women don't necessarily rule differently or less violently in the context of the patriarchal authoritarian system. She's going to do what she needs to do to protect her son. Second, in this risk-averse system, she's putting her young son on the throne. Who do you think it's most useful for her to get rid of? You guys all just got through seasons of Game of Thrones, right? You can think this through. This tomb is full mostly of males, and a lot of young males. And we can imagine King Den witnessing the murder of his own brothers by the hundreds. A brutal reality, this Dynasty One, and Mernaith is the one that is pulling the trigger. Each one gets a marker of their own. Each one gets a room of his or her own. The cause of death is not clear. The cause of death is, I have a grad student, a former grad student, Dr. Rose Campbell, who did her dissertation on this sacrificial burial. She's found trauma, like that you can actually witness, that could be perimortem or postmortem, meaning at the time of death, or it could be something that happened to the body after, in only 3 cases out of 1,000. And the archaeologists who work at this site think it's cyanide, that it's some sort of poison that people could drink and then die very quickly, potentially in the arms of their relatives. But die they did, and they are laid to rest as infants, as if they're sleeping in the fetal position. It is not this. You do see things from this time period where there's stabbing and violence, but these are not enemy combatants. This is not that kind of sacrifice. This is a different thing altogether. Now, Mernaith is the one in our story who did not become king. I think you've already figured that out, right? She's the one who is queen regent, but she is buried like a king. Because when she dies, even though it is not a vulnerable transition of power, king is dead, long live the king, they still bury her with hundreds of sacrificial victims herself. They bury her in a structure that looks like this. It's so confusing to the archaeologists, they thought she was a king. And yet, just 2-3 generations after this extraordinary rule by this formidable woman, she's erased. She's removed from the king lists. You have the list of king's names with the Horus birds. She is nowhere to be found. They go from one dynasty to another dynasty, no Mernaith. She doesn't need to be there. This is a typical pattern. Also connects with this Egyptian innovation. How do you maintain the idea of an authoritarian regime that continues dynasty after dynasty, father to son to grandson, for forever, God-given? You'll invite the female in sometimes, but that messes with the story. If her name is remembered, then that beautiful fiction of father to son to grandson for forever is marred. So she has to be removed, and she is erased from the history books, and you guys don't know her name. This is probably the first time most of you have ever heard the name Mernaith. She's not part of your cultural memory. She's not something that you grew up hearing. So that's our first. Neferu Sobek of Dynasty 12 is our second example, and she is the first one to actually take on the kingship herself. And I can say less about her than I can about Mernaith, because we don't have her tomb. We don't have any of the detritus of death in association with her. It's very hard to tell this woman's story, but there are some interesting clues that we can use. Now, just looking at her, you're like, okay, this is a very formidable woman herself, fearsome to behold even. She comes from a very, very strong and powerful family, the 12th dynasty, as Egyptologists call it. Her grandfather was this guy, Sinwasser III, who expanded the borders of Egypt farther than they had ever been. And her father is Amenemhet III, also expanding those borders and a warrior king. And then we get this nothing guy, Amenemhet IV, who dies after a short reign. And after him, Neferu Sobek becomes king herself, the first one to do it. So you've got this, I mean, think about it this way. You've got Egypt on the upswing, incredibly wealthy. Everything's going well. And they're taking more territory. Everything's going up. And then all of a sudden, you end it with a crisis of female rule that lasts for less than 4 years and that ends the dynasty. She takes on no husband, no lover. She has no progeny of her own. She's the last one. She's the last person standing. So you get this dynasty dying on this horrific sort of note. What could possibly cause something like that? How could you be so strong and powerful and not have a male to continue in this divine kingship line? There's no sons left? Do they all die in a massive epidemic? Oh, we keep coming back to that. How could the cholera is not going to kill the entire family? Why do you just have this woman left? What's actually going on? The Egyptians are going to tell us, because again, it's an authoritarian regime, But authoritarian regimes and people in power like to keep their power. And one of the main ways of making sure that your power stays in the family, literally, is this. So this is what I think happened. And there are other documented cases where you see a line ending with a king who produces no son whatsoever. A king producing no son whatsoever, that's potentially because he's not able to create anything, because he is such a product of incest himself that he's not viable as a father in any way, shape, or form. This is something that we know from Tutankhamun's DNA, and it's something that lest you think that Europeans are better than this, and Europeans, of course, upon which white America is built, I show you Charles II, who was a product of incest himself and had such a giant head that he had to sleep on a special pillow, and he always drooled, and yeah, this is a good portrait of him. The Habsburg Charles, yes? So Cleopatra's family, the Ptolemies, they engaged in incest on wild levels compared to the ancient Egyptians. So this is something that the Egyptians would do to keep money, influence, and power in the family. If you don't bring any in-laws, you don't have to give any jobs or money to those in-laws. It's a good short-term solution. Long-term solution, not so much. For those of you that look at this and go, this is the stupidest thing I've ever seen, what simple people, why would they ever do that? Then I would look at how human beings behave with something like human-induced climate change. We know it's happening, we see the sea levels rising, we see the temperatures going up, but then you get somebody saying, but we can't do anything about it because then we'll kill the jobs or this will happen. Humans think short term. They don't like to think long term. It's hard to think long term because the short term is what you're trying to maintain. So if you have a choice between two sons, let's say, one who's strong and handsome and you know, smart and really able, but he comes from this really powerful family, his mother's family. They're going to come into the palace. They're going to take influence and power. And then there's this other dude who's kind of dim, and he, you know, both of his parents, you know, the king married a sister, and that's his parentage. And you're like, oh, he's not very smart. He's not going to be that great a king. But you get to, you as the elite making the decision, get to keep your job. Your kids get the job after. You're going to go for the incestuous product. This is the way people think. So this is the way the Egyptians think, and this is why Neferusobek comes in as Egypt's first female king. And look at how she does it. She's here in this statue form, and she's wearing a dress. Those are the straps of the dress. And she layers the masculine kilt of kingship on her person, puts the Nemes headdress with those stripes on her head. So she doesn't hide that she's a female, but she's king nonetheless. Now, the way she rules is very interesting, too, because she makes sure to connect her kingship to that of her father, not to her dead husband. This is useful for us as well. Think of the American presidency, and think of how people can behave in the White House over the last 40 years. So I brought Hillary Clinton up earlier. I'm going to bring her up again. Think of Hillary Clinton trying to create a healthcare scheme in the 90s by only being the wife of Bill Clinton. No formal avenue to power, no elected office, but that's her way in. It was very challenging for people to accept that because she's there in an authoritarian system, no, but she's there on a peer level, which people find destabilizing, challenging, problematic. If you're trying to keep everything working in an authoritarian system or in our own system, you want it to work along a hierarchical line, which means you can trust the mother of the king. You can also trust the daughter of the king. So in today's White House, you can see Ivanka Trump does not receive pressure from her base to say, why do you occupy this position? Because it is understood that she will fit that hierarchy. Neferusobek does the same thing. Incredibly strategic, incredibly clever, incredibly imaginative for her to be able to come up with this means of justifying her rule. It's like her husband never even existed. Maybe he was her brother, we have no idea, but it's like he was never even there. She looks to the father and only the father. Now, Neferusobek dies after, you know, less than 4 years of reign. Dynasty ends with her. No progeny. You also don't remember her name. She's not necessarily erased outright from the history books, but she's certainly not remembered. Now let's move on to the third in our story, Hatshepsut of Dynasty 18. Hatshepsut is the most powerful of the women that we're discussing today. in that she ruled for decades. She ruled for 22 years altogether, left Egypt better than she found it, is an extraordinarily powerful female king. Now, how did she get there? She is the daughter of a king, she is the wife of a king, and she is the sister of a king because she married her half-brother. See, I didn't make the incest stuff up. It actually really did happen. She never became the mother of a king because she only bore a daughter. She never bore a son. And that's the strange twist of fate that paved her path to the kingship. Because when her half-brother dies after only 3 years of reign, he leaves her with a bunch of two-year-old boys, none of whom is her own. One of those two-year-old boys is chosen, named as king, and she is named as queen regent. She's not his mother. Something's off. Something's a little bit strange. And she is able to use that one-step removal to transcend her care for the boy, her interest in propping him up, and to make sure that she uses his kingship to create her own kingship. She's the god's wife of Amun. She's a priestess of the highest order in ancient Egypt, and she uses that as well to gain power. And while she's acting as high priestess and queen regent for this young boy, she starts to lay the path for her kingship. Now, right here is the word kingship, Nesut. And she tells us that the sun god Ra, you can see that, right? It's pretty clear. Sun god Ra gave to her, there's the gave, you see the little hand with the thing on it? This right here? Gave to her the kingship in truth. And that she's doing the job. She's doing it well. She doesn't name herself king. She doesn't show herself as king, but she is saying, look, I am doing the job. And she only communicates this to people who can read, which in ancient Egypt is what? Top 2%? Top 1%? It's nobody. She's depicting herself for everybody else in a very normal fashion. Look, I'm just a female priestess. Don't worry about me. Nothing to see here. But to the people who can read, she's like, I'm going to be king soon. Get ready. No pushback. She's able to do it. So here is her first depiction of herself as king, wearing a dress, showing her breasts. She's a female, but she's wearing a masculine wig and ram's horns. The ram is as masculine as you can get, so for her to place those upon her person is to start masculinizing her person. And Hatshepsut is very well known for the masculinization that she engages in. I'll show you in a bit. She's crowned, and we still don't know the exact reason why. The history books say things like Hatshepsut was greedy, Hatshepsut took something that wasn't hers to take, she's taking the kingship from Thutmose III, but don't ever forget that Hatshepsut never eliminates Thutmose III. They serve together side by side as kings until he dies. This is Hatshepsut in front, this is her nephew behind. Twinsies, in a way, kings side by side. She never has him removed, probably because she knows that if she kicks this guy out of office, then she's going to lose her position as well. She needs him. She takes the kingship in his year 7. Let's assume the kid is 9 years old at this point. What's he going to do? What's he going to say? She's going to sit on the throne next to him now, probably in a higher throne than his. She's always been the most powerful person in his life. This is not something that he's necessarily in a position to fight against. And Hatshepsut does everything right. She is a jobs creator. She's in control of the money. She's in control of the temple. She sends expeditions off to this mythical land of Punt that we don't even know where it is. It's in Eritrea. It's in Yemen. We're not quite sure. She tells us about bringing back incense trees, roots and all, from this place. And her men met this strange and misshapen chieftainess of Punt, and they depicted her in all her deformed glory. She built this temple. For those of you that have been to Egypt and been to Thebes, this is a wonder to behold. It is the first thing that your eye catches when you're down south in Luxor. But she couldn't, 20 years in power, did all this right. She couldn't make the position fit her. She had to fit the position. What I mean by that is she started out depicting herself like Nefer-Sobek, like a woman who layers the kingship upon her person. The next series of statues, she androgynizes. She is male and female at the same time. Here she's showing herself topless, shirtless, whatever you want to call it, wearing a masculine kilt, and yet you can see her form and features are very feminine, very gracile. She wants to kind of have her cake and eat it too. Finally, she throws in the towel, and most of the statues from her reign look like this, masculinized. big jaw, big muscles. She looks like a man. That's not because she necessarily wanted to do this. She wasn't like, oh, I just someday really want to be a cross-dresser. Or I have, you know, she identified more with the male gender. I don't think that's what's going on. She is putting on her pantsuit with shoulder pads, making sure she's wearing a chunky heel, putting her hair back, not too much makeup, don't wear a stiletto. You ladies, women, girls, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Let me put it this way. If women have to masculinize to have power in this world, how many of the guys in here are wearing dresses to get closer to power? Doesn't happen. I'm looking at the women out there today. You guys are wearing sweatshirts, you're wearing men's clothes. If you'd shown up here in 1950 wearing stuff like that, I mean, it would be shocking and strange. You'd all be in your crinoline skirts. Things have changed. Now you're allowed into the halls of power. You're dressed like it. Hatshepsut did the same thing. Now, the saddest part of her story is most of you can't pronounce the name Hatshepsut. Some of you have never heard of this woman, the most powerful of female leaders of all of ancient Egypt. Here she is giving obelisks of monolithic stone to the god Amun-Re. Even though she was buried in state by her nephew Thutmose III, she is removed from the history books. Every place that her name as king was carved, it is chiseled away. Those statues that I showed you, all smashed to smithereens with sledgehammers, destroyed, removed. So she's now not a part of the historical record. You can barely pronounce her name. You don't know what she did. They remove her on purpose. She can't be there anymore. She messes up the story. Our next Nefertiti. Nefertiti is my favorite of the moment right now because her story is very much being discovered by Egyptologists as we speak. The site that Nefertiti's bust now in Berlin was found is being excavated. It's been excavated for the last 100 years, but they are finding amazing things at this site that is changing her story so that she is now no longer just a pretty face. You know Nefertiti, don't you? But you don't know she was a king. You think she was just a queen, just a pretty face. You have no idea all of the stuff that is now surrounding Nefertiti in my world, my Egyptological world. Nefertiti starts out her life as a queen, marrying this dude, Amenhotep IV, son of Amenhotep III. Everything's pretty normal. And then this guy starts to depict himself like this. Strange, alien-like, pulled features, weird slit-like eyes, weird and deformed body. He changes the religion of Egypt when he does this. He's going to change his name as well. Nefertiti's form at the beginning looks like this. It looks like his. Weird pulled down chin, deformed features, tiny wrists, tiny ankles, and then this weird misshapen body in the middle. What is going on? This is the new religion. He closes down temples dedicated to Sobek, to Amun-Re, to Ptah, and says, no, there's one god, you guys. One god. I'm going to tell you what it is. It is the god Aten, he says to everyone, and you can only get to this god through me. You can see it in the sky. We now no longer need all of those statuettes, all of those temples that had little closed spaces. I'm going to build the temples. I'm the only one that can connect with this god. Pulls all of the funds away from those old temples that people believe in, that people need, and builds this instead. This is a top-down religious experiment of extraordinary imagination, but also quite destructive. These are the temples that he builds, all completely open to the sky. He pulls Egyptian religion up by the roots and he replants it in a new capital city. He abandons Memphis, Heliopolis, Thebes, moves out into the middle of nowhere to a place called Akhet Aten. He names it the horizon of the Aten, and he names himself Akhen Aten. Have you guys heard of this name? The one who is beneficial for the Aten. And this invention of monotheism brings her along for the ride. She's his great royal wife. She's his highest ranking queen. In less than 10 years, he starts to build this city up from nothing. And her name changes when he does this. He now calls her Nefer Nefru Aten Nefertiti. It's nothing. Just wait. There's two more. And it gets way worse. It gets way worse. He starts to depict her on the same scale as him. They're like co-kings in a sense, but not yet. And they show all these loving images with their daughters, and it's so sweet. It looks all sweet and lovely until you realize that he married these two and elevated them to great royal wife. And then it kind of gets a creep factor to it. Now, Egyptologists have looked at Akhenaten's reign, the invention of monotheism, these depictions of loving families, and seen what they wanted to see. They saw a religious thinker, an amazing man, somebody who was connected to humanity more than they'd ever seen before. But we are now finding the deep, dark secrets of this regime. He is showing himself here with Nefertiti, there's Akhenaten, throwing out solid gold trinkets to followers, mostly from the army, who agree to go with him on this strange and bizarre crusade of a new religion. When you co-opt people with cash to get the rule that you need, then you will likely get the rule that you deserve. And people who are excavating in the cemeteries of this place, not the cemeteries of the elite, but the cemeteries of the workers who built this city, are finding skeletons that show extraordinary trauma, long-term trauma, chronic acute trauma, chronic or acute trauma. They're finding even a graveyard of children separated from adults whose bodies show work camp-like conditions. These were children working starved, children working wounded, children working too long. This is how this city was actually built. And another one of my former graduate students, Ann Austin, who teaches at UMSL, University of Missouri in St. Louis, is working on these bodies. And they have to take breaks from the digs because it gets so disturbing to work in this children's cemetery and see the kind of trauma that he imposed on his people. It can become quite emotional, this work. At this time, Nefertiti gets a name change, and it seems that she becomes co-king. Now, here Egyptologists really start to argue with each other and fight. I would say that the amount of Egyptologists who think that Nefertiti became a co-king alongside her husband Akhenaten is about 60-70%. So it's not that crazy. Her name changes Ankh-Khepru-Re-Nefer-Nefru-Aten. So she now is becoming masculinized in a sense herself, like Hatshepsut before her. You can't even see the Nefertiti as was. She's had to leave that part of herself behind. Now, the coolest part of this story is that she even may have had this made for her. And this is a theory. If you want to go down a rabbit hole of what Egyptology is doing now, Google Nicholas Reeves and the burial of Nefertiti, and you will have so much fun. Because his theory, and I saw this mask up close with no glass, and I agree with him, that this that says Neb-Hepru-Re, that's Tutankhamun's throne name, actually had a different name underneath it. And the traces are visible. And that other name was Ankh-Khepru-Re. And this was potentially made for Nefertiti. I study coffin reuse. This whole coffin set of Tutankhamun was known to be reused for a long time. You can see the traces of reuse all over it. But we didn't know that it was reused from somebody named Ankh-Khepru-Re. And now we're figuring out that Ankh-Khepru-Re was potentially Nefertiti as co-king. This changes everything. So this is potentially Nefertiti, certainly not just a pretty face. Now, if you really want to start a bar fight amongst Egyptologists, go to the conference, which has just been canceled due to coronavirus, but go to the annual conference and just go up there and say, was Nefertiti Smenkhare? And people are like, who said that? No, she was not. Because the idea is amongst, I would say, 40% of Egyptologists, including myself, is that when Akhenaten died, Nefertiti stepped in as sole king for a very short period of time, but ruled on her own as the leader of state, and when she did so, she took on a new name. She keeps the Ankh-Khepru-Re, and then she adds to it the Smenkhare, Ankh-Khepru-Re Smenkhare. There'll be an exam after this. You have to get all three names. If you do, you get, I don't know, a coffin, something awesome. If Nefertiti is the sole ruler after the death of Akhenaten, then she's the one that's cleaning up the mess that he left for her with all of his crazy monotheistic experimentation. She's the one that opens the temples back up again. She's the one that finds a way to heal this place, this Egypt, and turns things back to the way that they used to be in a polytheistic sense. Now, these last two women, I wasn't going to talk about Tawasrud anyway, because this is as Game of Thrones as you can possibly imagine, and we have no time. A woman who ruled as sole king during a time period of civil war, but started out as a regent for a club-footed, incestuous product of the 19th dynasty. You can't get more Game of Thrones than that, but we must skip and move along to Cleopatra, whom you know, and you know well. You know that she took power as a ruler, but you may not then put her into the patterns of what we've seen already. She follows the same patterns of somebody like Hatshepsut, rules for an extended period of time, and yet never rules alone. Rules first alongside her father, Ptolemy the 12th, then rules alongside her brother, Ptolemy the 13th. Now, the Ptolemies all hate each other, and growing up in the palace as a Ptolemy, I can't think of a better way of getting PTSD, because everyone is trying to kill everybody all the time. This guy, her brother, dies fighting her in a war. And then she marries the next brother, Ptolemy the 14th. She has him assassinated. So now she has no Ptolemies left. She's the last one standing. She is the ruler. But Cleopatra, she is clever. She knows she's got to be really imaginative here. She's got to figure out how to create an authoritarian reign in which she does not rule alone. Because she knows as a woman she has to rule differently. She knows she has to invite a man into this situation. And you guys already know who that man is. You already know that Julius Caesar is the one who comes into this situation. And she has a baby with him. She happens to be in Rome with that baby, Caesarion, Ptolemy the 15th, as Egyptologists call him, when Caesar is killed on the steps of the Senate. She's got to hightail it back to Egypt. She needs another protector. Egypt is no longer all safe and cuddled up in its Nile Valley. It's now perched on the edge of the Mediterranean, being ruled from the city of Alexandria. It's now a different kind of place. So she looks to this guy, has three children with Mark Antony. Cleopatra is the one in our story that rules the most like a man. She's got her own harem, in a sense, but a harem of men, a harem of Roman warlords. She doesn't marry them. They already have wives. She doesn't need to marry them. They don't want to marry her. But she has four children with these different Roman warlords and then starts to set up each one of these kids in charge of a different place. You get Cyrenaica, Libya, you get Cyprus, you get Egypt with me, and so on and so forth. If it weren't for a series of disastrous campaigns, including the invasion of Parthia, Iran, by Mark Antony, what is in The Princess Bride, for those of you that have seen this movie, never have a land war in Asia. Big mistake. So he comes back from Parthia completely debilitated. And then they have one last throw of the dice in the Battle of Actium, which of course they lose. If they had not lost these battles, maybe we would talk about Cleopatra differently. But in the end, we do not. We talk about her suicide. I would like to stand up here and try to suggest, as an Egyptologist, that suicide is going to work very much in Octavian's favor. That's the guy who won the Battle of Actium. That's the guy who will set up an authoritarian system in Rome for the first time. That's the guy who will become Caesar Augustus. When he makes Cleopatra commit suicide in the propaganda, in the text, whether this actually happened or not, I doubt it, he masculinizes her. He takes her womanly self that protects her children, that is able to keep Egypt protected and safe, and with that suicide, turns her into somebody who takes the easy way out. Just because she doesn't want to be displayed in chains in a Roman triumph, just ends it all. Abandons Egypt to its fate. Abandons her children, especially her sons, to their fates. Both of her sons are hunted down and murdered by Octavian. This suicide is too easy. Cleopatra's story, if you compare it to Hatshepsut's, and this is where I will end, is the most useful for me. Because you guys all know the name Cleopatra. You can pronounce it with no trouble. It's not an easy name to pronounce. Lots of consonants in that one, too. But Cleopatra is set up for us in our cultural memory as the cautionary tale of what happens when a woman rules. She comes in a time of crisis? No, she is the one that brings the crisis, according to the historians. Every failure that she makes is aggrandized. Shakespeare's going to write a play about her. We're going to have Elizabeth Taylor playing her. We're still talking about Cleopatra. She's the one that we remember, and the one who did everything right, Hatshepsut. You can't even pronounce her name. Thank you very much.